And this is what happened, basically. So this is a two-photon calcium imaging. So this is a very sophisticated technique. This is a very old picture. This is the first time that they're imaging this. So this is like 20 years old. But now it's much nicer, the resolution. What you have in here is you put a fluorescent dye that it will change fluorescence when you have calcium. Okay, so it's a calcium sensor. You just shine a light, and the reflected light is going to give you an indication of how much calcium you have in there. And here you can, because of the two photons, it's a very sophisticated technique that allow you to even to image individual spines. Okay, so this will be this bright thing in there, it reflected some calcium in that spine, and you can quantify that brightness, and you can see how much calcium was in there. And you get a signal that are like this. So when you stimulate the synapse very locally, you get a local signal in one of those guys, which is very kind of small. If you produce action potentials to backpropagate all the way there, that invade, you also produce a signal. Okay. Now, if you give both simultaneously, okay, you produce a much larger signal. But the important thing is a superlinear. So the result of giving an action potential and activating the synapse at the same time is much larger than activating the synapse and added to an activated action potential. So it's superlinear. So the both processes are interacting. Okay. That's the, so this is when both of them together, and this is when you sum this plus that, all right? So it's superlinear interaction, and that was crucial. And there was something else which is very important in those experiments. So what they did, it was to activate the synapses and then deliver the action potential shortly after. And shortly after means in milliseconds, okay, not in seconds. And then, or they can deliver first the action potentials, make the cell fire the action potential, and then activate the synapses. Okay, so it's the same number of action potentials, the same number of synaptic events, it's just you're changing the time, who is first and who is later. And in this case, when you activate the synapse first, you get a big calcium signal in the spines, and when you do action potentials and then the synapse, you don't. So it's asymmetric. Okay, there's an asymmetric temporal ruling here, which is kind of understandable, because what you can think is like here, what you do is you activate the synapses, the presynaptic part release a glutamate, bound, that glutamate will bind the NMDA receptors and stay very happy in there. And if very soon you have a backpropagation action potential, which is very depolarizing, that's going to help the NMDA receptor to release the magnesium, and therefore they can be fully conductive of calcium, and LTP will happen. Okay, and normally the glutamate remain stuck to the NMDA receptor on the order of 20 to 50 milliseconds. Okay, so you have a little time window. You know, if you surprise the NMDA receptor, it's the backpropagating action potential surprise the NMDA receptor with a glutamate bound, you can activate it fully. The other way around doesn't work, because the action potential is very fast. Normally it lasts for a couple of milliseconds. Okay, so gone. All right, and then if you later you activate the NMDA receptor, well, it doesn't matter because the action potential is gone. All right, so that's it. That is the symmetry. So the glutamate remaining bound to the NMDA receptor for like 20 or 50 milliseconds, the action potential is very fast and doesn't, and that explains the thing. But the consequence would be that this probably would produce LTP, this one probably not. Okay, and that is actually the implementation of the famous Hebb rule and Stent rule. So the Hebb rule is say that the cell A fire before and makes cell B to fire, okay, first the synaptic activation and then the action potentials, then you should get LTP. And the other way around, if cell A fire B fire first and then A, you should not get LTP, and perhaps you should get long-term depression. Okay? And with all of that kind of conceptual framework and experimental advances, people did experiments and actually it worked like that, okay? So this is not the first guy to demonstrate, but this is one that demonstrated very clearly. So this is the result in the cortex. So what the guys are doing here, they are recording in here a cell in the this cell in the cortex. They stimulate it with this black metal electrode. This one here is to the liver, some other stuff you don't care. Okay? And this is what they found. This is time, and this is the response. This is a synaptic response. And this is a little artifact. Anytime you stimulate in here, you produce a little artifact. Okay? But this is the synaptic response. So the synaptic response is like this, and it's kind of variable, but it's stable. Okay, it goes tan, 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 but then around the same level. And here, they keep the liver in the same, at the same rate, but the only thing that they did is that they make the cell to fire a sharp action potential right after the synaptic activation. So this is the synaptic activation, and this is the action potential. Synaptic activation, action potential, okay? And they keep doing for like 10 minutes or so, just putting one action potential in there, and the result is potentiation, okay? Now, in this other experiment with another cell, and this is before and after, they did the opposite. So the pairing, it was such that they make the cell fire an action potential, and immediately, like 10 milliseconds after, they activate the synapse, okay? And in that case, it's long-term depression. So the beauty of this paradigm, and that why it's called a spike time independent plasticity, is because it depends on the timing between the synaptic activation and the action potentials. Just that. Because the amount of stimulation in here and in here is exactly the same. So it just depends on who fires first, it's going to determine whether you're going to go up or down. And that's what it's calling it. Okay. And in this, so people want to study the thing, okay? There are many, many examples and many, and basically they have documented and reported spike time independent plasticity in almost any interesting synapse in the brain, in the cortex, in the hippocampus, in the cerebellum, in the amygdala. Whenever you may want to learn something, you have spike time independent plasticity. And it calls for the timing calls for the polarity and the magnitude. So here in this experiment, what they're doing is to vary, this is the action potential and this is synaptic activation, then varying the delta, you know, synaptic activation, delta, and then action potential. The other way around, okay? So when you vary, it turns out that you have, for instance, for the LTP part, okay? So this is the LTP, synaptic activation, action potential. You can get LTP, you do it very shortly after, and then the amount of potentiation is decay over time, and basically by 50 milliseconds you don't get any potentiation, which is commensurate with the time that the glutamate remain bound to the NMDA receptor. So if the action potentials arrive at 100 milliseconds when the NMDA receptor already lost its glutamate, is not going to do anything, okay? So it's a very sharp time window. So basically, it tells you that you have to have correlated pre- and post-synaptic activity in the order of the 20 milliseconds to compute plasticity, okay? And that's something that it seemed reasonably to happen in the real world, okay? And there's another cool thing of this one, which is the case of the presynaptic activation followed by postsynaptic activation is kind of like a causality, okay? Because basically it's just the Hebb rule. It's like if cell A fire and then cell B to fire, the interpretation that one can have is that, you know, cell A is causing cell B to fire, okay? So it's an implementation basically of a causality rule at the level of a synapse in a single cell. Okay, so needless to say, people in computer neuroscience love that. Okay, basically because you may do inference about who happened first in the world basically using this causality rule. Okay, so and it's strictly based on the temporal correlation, not on the level of activity, okay? So it's causality. And in the other attractive thing is that in principle, if you were to record from a monkey or even for a person, the trains of action potential that's been produced in a particular cell and a few cells, you can analyze them, and then from this spike time independent rule, you could compute whether those connections are going to get stronger or weaker without the need for, you know, measuring how much NMDA receptor activation you get. Because the only information that you need is the relative time between firing the presynaptic cell and the postsynaptic cell. And that's the only information that you need to predict plasticity. So it's a very powerful thing. Okay, so now how it happened, as I told you, the rule for the LTP is very simple, you know. If presynaptic fire and then the postsynaptic fire is basically the action potential is boosting the activation of NMDA receptor. The other way around is not clear. Okay? So why, when the postsynaptic cell fired the action potential first, and then the presynaptic fire, why that's conducive to LTD, there are one, two, three major hypotheses. Okay, I'm just going to say them because they're just hypotheses and they're equally standing. One is says that, you know, when you have an action potential, you also open some calcium channels, and the action potential by itself, it allows some local increase of calcium. It's not that big, but it's just a little bit, so it would be good to combine with a little bit of NMDA receptor. You put two little scoops together and you made enough for LTD. That's the idea. There's another one that calcium enters through NMD desensitized the NMD. This is just weird. Okay, forget it. Okay, can't think I can. And this is even weird because this is very bureaucratic, but it happened. Okay, so this is just weird. Nobody has shown it, and this is weird but bureaucratic and happened, but it's only very early in development. So what happened is that somehow the action potential helped to produce this endocannabinoid, yeah, the same thing of marijuana. And then it somehow that act on the presynaptic terminal and reduce the release of glutamate, okay? It's a very convoluted thing, but it happened in a few cases, not in all of them, okay? So the bottom line is, it's very clear why the LTP part work. It's not clear why the LTD part work, but the LTD part, it does work, okay? So we know that happened, we don't know the mechanism. Okay, so 20. So I'm going to go now to the second part. So basically, the current model of LTP and LTD is spike time independent plasticity. And the idea is that you compute the correlations between pre and postsynaptic activity. When they're correlated, potentiate. When they're not correlated, they depress. So as I told you, I'm going to talk about now about metaplasticity, which is also very important for the real world, which is the regulation of synaptic plasticity. And you need to regulate synaptic plasticity because LTP and LTD are intrinsic feed-forward mechanism. Okay? So what happened, and those are very unstable. So if you have a network, you know, with many, many, many cells, and you know, you let them act, and it's initially favored to LTP. What happens is that you induce a little bit of LTP in the network. Well, you're going to get more synaptic strength, and that's going to produce more synaptic activity, and which in turn is going to produce more LTP at the next one, and then you're going to saturate very quickly. Okay. So actually, similarly with the LTD, if you have a network which is initially slightly inclined to LTD, okay, you're going to get LTD, you're going to get less synaptic activity and more LTD and going down. So basically those are very unstable mechanisms, okay? So it's very difficult to maintain them in a kind of like in a middle level. So those network with LTP or LTD only, they tend to either to go to the roof or to go to the floor very quickly, okay? And people notice that very early in the 80s when they start to think about LTP and LTD. So they start to add some mechanism which is kind of like a silly mechanism, like for instance an exponential decay. Okay, so you get LTP, but then eventually LTP is going to come down, or you get LTD, but eventually it come down, so you kind of get a little bit more stable. But but LTP and LTD by itself are very unstable. Yeah, so you can see that. So what you wanted to have is actually to implement a negative feedback mechanism such that if you have an increase in the synaptic response and an increase in neural activity, somehow you're going to reduce the synaptic responses. Okay? Or if you have a decrease in the synaptic response, well, somehow you're going to increase the neural activity so everything can go back to a set point. Okay? So you need a feedback mechanism that brings the whole network to a set point. And, oh yeah, and there was also experimental need for that. And I'm going to explain you this. So this is the experiment I told you about closing the eye of the poor kitten. Okay, I never did those experiments, okay, so don't. Okay, so I never tortured a cat. Okay, but these experiments are very classical. So if you stimulate one eye, you get a response. These are action potentials, this is a stimulus. And you also get a response in the left eye. And normally they're kind of like equal, okay? But now, if you close one eye, and normally just switch to the eyelid, so you close it. Now these days they do it with super glue, okay? Just for 2 days, and then you reopen. You know, you just close it for 2 days and then you reopen. And it turned out the response evoked by the formerly closed eye are very weak. Okay? And then don't worry, the guy come back very, very soon. But, okay? But you have this depression, okay? And the idea was obviously LTP and LTD. So that's the explanation. So what you have is when you close the eye, the right, this is right. You should say the left. Okay, never mind. Okay, I made a mistake in there. Okay, please take notice. All right. So the open eye, you know, it produces a lot of action potentials, and the closed eye produces very few because it's closed. Okay, and this correlates, and this drives the postsynaptic cell, and these guys are happy. But this is totally uncorrelated with that one, and it's going to get depression, just like a spike time independent plasticity, for instance. Okay. Uncorrelated and depressed. Perfect, so far so good, everybody was happy, you know, papers were produced, grants were getting, but there was one experiment that was kind of hard to interpret, which was the reverse suture. So you close this eye, okay, and then of course by this time, this eye is disconnected, and if you do it for a long time, not just today, but do like four days, this eye gets completely disconnected. No responses, basically, all right? And then you switch. You close the other eye and open the former eye. That's a very nasty thing to do, okay? But the prediction it was, okay, so the only eye that which is open is the disconnected one. This guy should become blind, okay? That's the, it should become blind. But no, after a while, you know, this eye reconnected and this disconnect. Okay, so how it happened? Because if you use the classical spike time independent plasticity rules and LTP rules and LTD rules, the guy should become blind. But actually, it just readjusts and reconnect one eye and disconnect the other eye. So, in thinking about that, came the notion of a sliding threshold, the VCM model, Bienenstock, Cooper, and Munro. And I like this because this is one of the few theories in cellular neuroscience that have been very effective and very simple, intuitively simple, and very easy to quantify it and proven experimentally. Okay, so this guy actually is this guy, Cooper. Cooper actually got the Nobel Prize for the Cooper pairs. So he's studying superconductivity. And after getting the Nobel Prize, found that there is nothing more to do with the superconductivity, so he decided to move to some more interesting realm of learning, and he decided to try neuroscience. So he said the following, and it's a very, suppose that we describe synaptic activity, okay, and changes in weight, just like I showed you before, you know, this could be a frequency or voltage, you know, you have a realm of LTD and a zone for doing LTP and a kind of like a crossover point, okay? That's, you have seen that many, many times. Actually, he is the first guy who proposed that this kind of a curve, okay, even before people discovered it. But. So he said, okay, so you have this nice curve and you have a crossover point in which at that particular, if you hit that, you're gonna get very little change, okay? And he said, well, suppose, and I propose that this phi is not fixed. So it can change depending on the history of activity of the cell. And that we can explain all kinds of things, and we can make the thing very stable. So if you measure normally here, now if the cell have been very active, producing a lot of action potentials, okay, you don't want any more LTP. So you slide the threshold, especially to the right. So now, the activity or the condition that before it produced LTP, now it no longer produces LTP, actually it may produce LTD. Okay, so you make more difficult to produce LTP and more easy to produce LTD. So now eventually the amount of activity will come back because you are depressing the. On the same token, you know, if the cell have been very, very little active, you know, with very few action potentials, well, you wanna promote LTP. You wanna make the synapse stronger, so now you can get more action potentials. You follow that? And therefore, you reduce the threshold. And in doing that, so also you make it more difficult to produce LTD. So in both cases, in one case you are promoting LTP at the expense of LTD, and the other case you are promoting LTD at the expense of LTP. And the idea is that if you let that go, you can get, and they show it, you can get a very stable system, you know, that always converges to the set point. And this is the way to explain the experiment with the cat. So basically, the cat was sitting here before, and when you close the eye, what happened is that, you know, one eye get disconnected, but then when you close both eyes, when you do the reverse suture, and the only eye open was the disconnected eye, there was no activity, basically, zero activity. So what happened is that the threshold for inducing LTP went all the way to the left. So now it's very easy to do LTP. So easy that just basically random chance, random coincidence can produce LTP now, okay? And that's the way why the guy regained to the things, okay? So the idea is that the conditions for inducing LTP and LTD are not rigid, but they can be changed in an adaptive way depending on the history of use of the cell. Okay, and that will produce a very stable neural network. Maybe some. Some water. Let me see. Okay. And I'm just going to say for a moment that the BCM model basically is another example of a theory preceding experimental confirmation by decades. So the BCM model, I think, was proposed in the 1980s, and the first experimental confirmation of that, I will talk later, came in the 1995, so 15 years later. So neuroscience is full of examples of very enlightened ideas that are being demonstrated to be true to some extent. But here we're going to go to in the opposite way. This is another model that provides stability to the neurons, to the networks, but it's one that starts first as an experimental empirical evidence and then built up from empirical evidence. So these are experiments done in culture cells in a dish. So you throw a whole bunch of neurons in there in a dish, and then they manage to connect together, okay? And they connect together, and then they have some kind of a spontaneous activity that you can measure, boing, boing, boing. These are action potentials, and these are synaptic responses. So you can record one of those cells, you don't see it very well. And then you can do a very simple experiment. Take one of those dishes and put them TTX, which block sodium channels, so you prevent action potentials, so you prevent basically all of the activity for a while. And then for a few days, and then wash it out, the TTX, and see what happened. Well, it turned out that now they have a lot of activity. They're bursting almost epileptic. And do the converse experiment. You can put bicuculin. So in these dishes, you have excitatory neurons and inhibitory neurons, okay? So they're kind of balancing each other, so you cannot get too much excitation, you don't get too much inhibition. But if you put this bicuculin, you kill inhibition. So for a while, the cells are hyperexcitable, there's epileptic, and the dish is jumping all over the places. So you keep that in a while, but after a while, they kind of recover and look normal, okay? But when you remove the bicuculin now, it turned out that the activity is much lower in frequency than in the normal case. So if you incubate, if you kill the activity with something and then you remove it, you get more activity. If you enhance the activity and then you remove the enhancer, you get less activity. So it looked like a feedback mechanism in there. The question is, what is the feedback mechanism? Okay, so why these guys get enhanced activity? Always. Oh, here it is. And the answer is the synapses. Okay, and so what happened is that synapses, individual synapses, all get changed in those. And this is a pyramidal cell, and each one of those round things represent a synapse, okay? And what happened, and that was so what happened is that they measure, and everything after you incubate the dish with the TTX, to block activity, and then you see that the activity, after you remove the TTX, is bigger. What happens is that the synapses, all of them get bigger, okay? But importantly, and that's the cute thing about this, all of them get bigger in the same scale. So what I did is basically, I multiply all of these sizes by a factor of 2 here, okay? But it happened in real life, okay? This is happening with Adobe, but it can happen in the real life. On the other hand, when you put bicuculin to overactivate them, what happens is that the reaction was to reduce all of the synapses, but also by the same factor. And the fact that they reduce or enhance in a compensatory manner by the same factor is crucial. And is that the beauty of this model? Because it preserves memories. So it's a way of changing the excitability of the network, but at the same time preserving the stored memories. So they remember that the synaptic theory of memory is that memory is encoded as changes in synaptic strengths of individual synapses. So if we start with a tabula rasa with all of them equal, one learning episode, it means that these and these guys get bigger, and this and this and this get smaller, okay? And if you want to change the excitability, Well, you still want that this be three times bigger than that one. Okay, so these guys accomplish that because if you make it all of them bigger by the same factor, this one is still three times bigger than the other one, and this one is still three times bigger than the other one. So by changing all of the synapses in the cell by the same factor, you ensure two things. One, you can change the excitability of the network, but at the same time you preserve memories, which is very important. Because if you want to accomplish excitability and you don't do that, then it's going to be no good for the memory. So this is another way of 14, 11, yeah. Just another way of saying that. So you have, let me see here. So you have two synapses. Okay, with different sizes, and if you have a reduced activity in the network, you want to increase those, but you want to keep the same relative size. And if you have an increased activity, you want to reduce but keep the same relative size. The way that you can demonstrate that all of them are changed by the same factor is doing this analysis that I'm just going to explain it to you quickly, okay? So I'm not going to interrogate you, but it's basically what you can do. You put an electrode and you collect all of the spontaneous responses for like about 10 minutes. So you get a sample basically of how they are. But you can order them. You can do a probability distribution, okay? So this is the probability distribution, okay? So this is the size, and the smaller one is here. Go from 0 to 100 or to 1, and it turned out that if you increase the size, basically this is the initial probability distribution, the distribution go to the right, okay? But then if you take this one and divide it, every single response that you record by the same factor, you get the same initial probability of distribution basically. So it's a way to confirm, let's put it this way, there's a way to confirm that the changes are multiplicative, that you're multiplying every single synapse by the same factor. You can ask me later if you want. It will require at least 10 minutes to explain, and I have only 5, so. But believe me, because we are approaching the end. Yep. So. So I talked to you about two mechanisms to control the network excitability by adjusting a synaptic function. One is the sliding threshold, and then is the scaling I compare here. Both of them are global, okay? Because both of them affect all of the synapses within a cell. LTP and LTD are local. So the idea is that only the synapse that was activated, the one in the 10,000 synapses get changed. Here are global, all of the 10,000 synapses are going to be changed at the same time, in the same direction, in the same manner, okay? And there are evidence for that. And the evidence for that, that's me, and this is my wife, okay? So the evidence, so what I did to demonstrate that it's a sliding threshold, and the idea is that if the synapses on the network have been very little active, you should reduce the threshold for LTP. You should get more LTP for the same buck, basically. And the experiment is relatively simple to do, kind of afterthought, with the visual cortex. Because you have LTP in the cortex, and the visual cortex is visual. So you just take the rat, throw it in a dark room for a few days, basically, and you're going to reduce the activity in the visual cortex because there's going to be nothing to see in there, all right? And then you can open the door and take the rat and measure LTP, and guess what? LTP is increased. So you can cut the slices and you can take the sister or the brother of that rat, and then it has been reared normally, and you can compare LTP in the dark rear guy with the normal rear, and the dark rear will have more LTP. Okay, so that's a demonstration that the threshold can slide. And how you can demonstrate synaptic scaling? The same thing, just again put the guy in the dark. Okay, but in this case, instead of measuring, you know, FTP, what you measure is synaptic responses. And it turned out that animals that have been exposed to the dark, the synaptic responses in the visual cortex are much bigger. Consider with the synaptic scaling. All right, so there's evidence for both. Okay, and in both cases, the idea is not going to affect stored memories. In this case, because you modify all of them by the same factor, and in the case of the synaptic selecting threshold, it's because you are not changing the synaptic weights, you're just changing the capacity to modify them. All right, so, and actually, the big question now that we and other people have is that. Cannot be just the sliding threshold, kind of like this, the opposite side of synaptic scaling. I mean, are those two different mechanisms, or maybe just one mechanism? Okay, basically, and you can go both ways. So, for instance, synaptic scaling. So you have bigger synaptic responses, and if you have a bigger synaptic response, it's going to be much easier to induce LTP because you know you're going to get more action potential and more things. So that's kind of obvious that. There's no, and on the other hand, if you have slide the threshold, so it's now much easier, ridiculously simple to get LTP. Well, just the random activity on the visual cortex that you may have in the dark may be sufficient to produce LTP. And since it's random, it's going to affect everybody, and by the same factor because randomness is doesn't care about who are you. So actually, in a way, both of them can be the same. And actually, once I posed that question to Leon Cooper, the developer of this guy, and say, yeah, so it can be basically two axioms that can be interconvertible, basically. So, but the bottom line here is that you need to have this homeostatic, well, at least one homeostatic mechanism to allow a stability of the networks, and there is evidence for both of them. Now, whether the both of them are the same, it remains to be determined, okay? And you have 2 minutes now. Any questions to fulfill these 2 minutes? Everything is clear? And you like it? You believe it? Okay? You can go now to the world and say, yes, I understand, you know, the basic mechanisms of how the brain codes memories? Well, okay.